The thing we're trying to do here is talk about, like, exactly as an object, what makes it objecty. In terms of, like, low-level causal graph. So, in the case of the vase, we've got a pretty good approximation, two different kinds of conserved quantities that are involved here. One of them is the geometry of the vase, right? So, like, the vase is staying roughly the same shape as I move it around over time. You can see that, right? Like,
yeah.
You see the vase at this time, and then, like, I hide it, and then you see it at later time, you're like, ah, I can still see it's roughly the same shape.
Yep.
I look at this little patch of it, and I know where this little patch is and what its orientation is, then I'm going to know where that little patch is and what its orientation is. So the geometry of the vase is conserved over time. However, there's a second interesting conserved quantity, the trajectory, or more narrowly, the trajectory state at a certain time. What do I mean by that? Well, if I look at the vase just at a particular time, so freeze it at this time, I look at the position and orientation of this little piece of the vase. Right, I look at that right there. I can see where it is, how it's oriented, how fast it's moving at that time.
Yep.
Then I also know the position and orientation and velocity of this part of the vase. So that information is distributed across space, right? If I have a bunch of Markov blankets cut spatially through this vase, I have information that's distributed from here to there. So I have that the high-level state of the vase, its velocity, its position, its orientation, its angular momentum.
Yep.
That information is a conserved quantity spatially at any given time, right?
And that's not the geometry?
That's not the geometry. The geometry is like the relative relationships between these things. So, like, I can know the geometry of the vase in general, right? Like, say I've got this 3D mesh model of this vase somewhere on my computer, right?
Yeah.
And the geometry, like, I need to know the geometry in order to do the thing where, if I know where this piece is, I know where that piece is, right?
Okay.
But, like, if I know the geometry, I still don't know, like, if I'm holding this vase behind my back, I don't know how it's oriented.
Yeah, okay.
Right? But if I know the geometry, and I know how this one little piece is oriented, then I know how the rest is oriented.
Yeah.
So that actually highlights another interesting point, which is this information about the state of the vase, it's like orientation and position, is distributed over space after you know the geometry.
Yep.
So it's like a conditional conserved quantity.
It's conditional on
the geometry.
The geometry.
Bingo.
Okay, that seems a little weird.
Mm-hmm.
Conditional conserved quantity. That sort of highlights how much the conservation is in your map instead of in the territory.
Correct.
Which is not, in general, true of conserved quantities.
Now, we can build this up, like, in a more from-the-territory sort of way. We can say, like, well, the geometry of the vase is something that you can, like, back out from the territory before you have all this trajectory stuff. Like,
yeah.
You can see that this shape is sort of showing up again and again over time.
Yeah.
And then, once you've got that, you can be like, then at this time, if I, like, know the geometry, then I also have this distributed information. So you can build it up that way.
Okay.
Another way to view it would be, in some sense, we could actually say it's the other way around. If I just track this little piece of the vase,
yep.
And I track, like, its whole trajectory over time,
yep.
Then knowing that trajectory tells me the trajectory of any other piece of the vase.
If you know the geometry.
If you know the geometry. Hold on. No, sorry. I didn't explain that right. Back up. It's supposed to be, if you know the trajectory, then you get... Oh, right.
If you know the trajectory of both parts, then you can...
If you know the trajectory, then the geometry becomes distributed information.
Right.
Because if I know the position and orientation of the vase at each time...
Right.
And I've got, like, a bunch of time snapshots of the universe, then I can be like, ah, all right, at time one, I have to go look here. What's there? At time two, I go look here at this orientation.
Yeah.
And I should see, like, there's something, some, like, shape that's conserved between those two. Now I can back out the geometry.
Right.
Right.
That's specifically if you're, like, looking at any given 2 points on the base, you know the trajectory of any given 2 points on the base. You know the geometry between those two points.
Or you can then look at the state of the universe and back out the rest of the geometry pretty easily.
Okay.
Why is all this important? A big part of why this matters is because it's sort of very intuitive to think of objects as like conserved quantities, right? Like geometry of the base, conserved over time, that's pretty intuitive. A thing that people usually don't notice right away is that usually objects have properties that are associated with them somehow, but change over time. So in this case, it would be like the position, orientation, and velocity of this vase as it's moving.
Yeah.
That's stuff that's changing over time, so it's not part of like the geometry of the vase that's conserved over time, and yet it's somehow like associated with that geometry, right? These two pieces, the trajectory and the geometry, sort of go together.
Yeah.
And that allows us to talk about how objects can change over time while still remaining the same object. Does that make sense?
For instance, their location changes.
Bingo. So there's a, like, there's these properties that are distributed spatially at a given time.
Yep.
That are changing over time. That are, like, if you know the thing that's conserved over time, the geometry, then there are also these properties that are conserved spatially.
Yeah.
That can change over time.
Yeah, so there's the shape of an object,
mm-hmm.
and there's the position, momentum, orientation of an object.
Mm-hmm.
And
in the case of a rigid body object, that's basically the whole story.
Yeah.
For something like a shirt, now you've got a lot more degrees of freedom to play with.
Yeah.
But, you know, same concepts, just more degrees of freedom.
Right. Where the degrees of freedom are in sort of the shape that the shirt, there's the shape of the shirt in the sense of the more or less, the more or less conserved structure of the shirt,
mm-hmm.
And then there's the shape of the shirt, which is how it's balled up or whatnot.
Yep.
Are there other features? I guess you could be like, there's the, like, objects have temperature,
mm-hmm.
but that's just included in the details of the components making it up.
I mean, temperature is like also a high-level quantity.
Yeah.
It happens, like in practice, mostly temperature ends up decoupling pretty well from geometry and trajectory for like most rigid body objects most of the time, but like it is still a sort of a part of it if you want to be complete about things.
Yeah. Other properties? It seems like the shape and the location, momentum, orientation seem like the two...
Definitely the most common and the biggest ones.
Yeah.
Yeah, that basically...
And also other properties that objects have break down into some version, like you're like... How well lit is it?
Mm-hmm.
That's like about interactions with photons.
Mm-hmm.
How heavy is it? That's like about the substance that's made out of, which is, I guess, included in the
geometry.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's right.
Okay.
Yeah, so we can talk about like there being an object that's sort of sticking around over time, and like maybe it's moving around, maybe even it's deforming if it's like a shirt, that sort of thing. Time to get a second base. Alright, now I want to talk about how these two vases are like the same thing in some sense, right? These are two instances of roughly the same vase pattern.
Okay, one of them has a sticker.
One of them, yeah. Someone took the sticker off of this one. But they're both apparently cylinder 12588 from IKEA. Yes, very, very clearly matching. So again, we can talk about this in terms of like information that's conserved. If you like, for instance, see this base, you can sort of inspect it. You could, for instance, measure it. You can measure how long it is, what the circumference is at the top, and then be like, okay, those same measurements probably apply to this one, because like I can see that these are both cylinder 12588 from IKEA, right?
Yeah.
So that's information that's distributed across space, and also as far as these things are sticking around, is distributed across time. Now, as with the case of a single object, there's that like there's some amount of geometry that's conserved between them. However, each of them is also going to have some parameters associated with the base itself that's serving a similar role to the trajectory. So they each have a position and an orientation that's specific to that vase.
Yep.
Just like for a single vase at any given time, it has like a position and orientation that's specific to that time.
The thing you just said seems obvious. I'm not sure if I missed
it. It should be obvious.
Okay.
This should not seem super subtle.
Okay.
The main point I'm making here is that like the thing going on across two objects that are like instances of the same category is qualitatively essentially the same thing that's going on with like one object that's sticking around over time. That should make sense intuitively, yeah?
Yep.
Cool. Now there is still a quantitative difference. Like if I take a microscope to this one, I'm gonna expect to see some structure that sticks around over time that
yeah.
I wouldn't see if I go look at that one.
Right.
So there's like quantitatively a lot more geometry being conserved with this one object propagating through time than there is across these two objects.
Yep.
That brings up a like more general property of information that's conserved in a big causal graph, is it is a lot easier in some sense for information to just like propagate along a line over time than for information to be spread out across space. Because in order for information to be spread out across space, it has to sort of fill a cone, right? It has to sort of fill all that sort of space in between.
What's an example of information propagating across space? You're like...
So an example here, a simple example would be something like pressure in this room is
yeah.
distributed across the whole room, right? In order for that information to get there, it had to like come from something upstream, right? Because we're in a causal system, the only way that two things that are spatially separated could end up having the same information in them is if that like came from someplace upstream or multiple places upstream.
Okay.
Whereas for information to just like propagate in one spot, like for instance, maybe if I take a microscope to this glass and I look at the relative positions of some defects right here, that just sort of stays in one place over time. That's information that doesn't really need to spread out.
Yeah.
And therefore I can have a very large number of little defects in here, like a mole of them. Probably not a whole mole, probably a few orders of magnitude less than that, but like a very large number of them that are conserved over time in a way that won't typically happen over space. I won't typically get like very large amounts of information distributed over space like that.
For solids, for gases.
Same thing for gases. The stuff that's distributed over space, like your pressure is going to end up distributed over space, your temperature is going to end up distributed over space, because those are the things that are sort of equilibrating.
Yeah.
But other than that, the like low-level details of molecules moving around over here are not going to be correlated with the low-level details of molecules moving around over there.
Okay.
So, yeah, general principle here is like a lot easier for information to get distributed over time than over space. And that's part of why objects are like pretty common interesting patterns.
Okay.
Anyway, back to the story of two vases. So we said like there's a similar thing going on with two vases that we have going on with one vase. Similarly to the one vase case, we can talk about there's sort of this conserved geometry, and then there's some sort of free parameters where we're like, okay, I have to sort of fit a position and orientation to this vase to say like, here's how the geometry matches up to it, and then I can say, all right, there's a vase here. And that, now we have the pieces to go back to our story of E. coli. Or actually at this point, we're not even to E. coli yet. Like very simple sort of life form, right?
Okay. E. coli is too complicated?
It'll be a while before we get to E. coli. There's a lot of pieces there. So we've got this like thing that's surviving, reproducing. We've talked about like the one thing surviving and reproducing in a way, essentially like a vase. You've got some geometry and possibly some like properties that we wouldn't normally call geometry, but like things that are conserved over time. And there's going to be some parameters associated with those that are changing, like things could be in different places, that sort of thing. And then in a conceptually similar way, you can get like multiple copies of the thing, both later on and like spatially distributed.
Yep.
Similar concept to two vases. You've got like something, some conserved quantity, something that's distributed over space, and then for each of those instances, you've got some sort of free parameters that you can fit to it to say like, this one is at like this position, that's a fact that's spatially distributed over this instance of the thing, because like I can see that it's at this orientation by looking at this part of it or looking at this part of it. And then if I go look at someplace over here where there isn't a cell, protocell, whatever this is, if I go look at some place over there, I am not going to be able to find like, you know, six parameters of position and orientation such that my three-dimensional mesh model of the vase matches whatever is in that chunk of space. Make sense?
Because it's not there.
Because it's not there. Yeah.
Okay.
Or rather, this is like sort of what it means when we're saying it's not there is because, like, for instance, you could, like, you've got sort of a bunch of molecules in this chunk of space, right? Like, let's say there's some ideal gas there.
Yeah.
Like this ideal gas in this chunk of space. You could come up with some completely ridiculous mapping that like maps those molecules to a vase, right? And then be like, it fit. I fit my extremely high dimensional model and said, yep, there's a vase there. Like,
okay.
Can't do that because like you only have these few degrees of freedom to fit to the thing.
Okay. Yeah, so that's what it means for there to be an object.
Mm-hmm.
Or two of an object.
Yep. Good with that?
I think so.
Cool. Then I think we are ready to get to abiogenesis.
Okay.
So at this point, we're past the more, say, philosophical parts for a while. Can get to the next sort of section is going to be walking through storytelling of how various various properties of agency sort of show up via evolution. So the very first thing we're going to start with, actually, let me take a picture of this before I erase it. The very first thing we're going to start with is how do we get things that reproduce at all? How do we get the original units that can evolve? Which is abiogenesis.
Okay.
So the usual starting point here, the step like immediately before abiogenesis, is typically self-amplifying chemical reactions. So let's talk about what that would mean. First of all, the machinery we just went through for bases, you probably see how like that would allow us to talk about there being lots of instances of a particular molecular species, for instance. So for instance, we could say there's a whole bunch of sugar molecules in this solution.
Yep.
Right, same way that we talk about bases. Or there's a bunch of this particular protein in the solution, that sort of thing. Right?
Yep.
So that means we have the machinery to talk about molecular species, their concentrations, like how many of them are in there. And then from there, next level up, we can start to talk about chemical reactions. So if you've got like this species and that species, and you've got like two instances of them that get close enough together, they tend to spit out these other species, right? Chemical reaction. And we're specifically interested in the case where a chemical reaction accelerates itself. So for instance, you've got, say A plus B produces some C, and this reaction is catalyzed by C itself.
Okay.
So if you don't have any C around, you'll just get these pools of A and B sort of sitting there.
Yep.
Once you've got a C in there, suddenly it starts producing more and more C.
Yeah.
And this like population of C molecules explodes over time.
Okay. Until you run out of A or B.
Until you run out of A or B, exactly.
Yep.
I don't have in my notes like references to this, but like people have examples of these. We can like build systems like this in the lab. It's a thing.
Yeah.
And this is sort of like the earliest forms of life, or the earliest things that come right before life, usually assumed to involve something along these lines. So this is like, this doesn't quite look like a life form yet. It feels like there's stuff missing. We're going to talk in a minute about like what sorts of stuff might still be missing.
No membranes.
No membranes is indeed going to be number one.
Yeah.
But it's like sort of intuitively
doing
the self-reproduction thing.
Yeah.
It's not quite a thing that's ready to undergo evolution yet, but it's real close to that. Jargon for this is an autocatalytic reaction. So
yeah.
If you want to Google that later, that's the word. Let's talk about a couple of stories for how we could first get things that look a bit more like organisms. So one story that I got from Terence Deacon, this is probably a false story, but it's like the sort of false story that will sort of usefully illustrate the possibilities.
Okay.
One story is, imagine you've got some sort of autocatalytic reaction like this, but it also spits out this thing D. And D is a molecule which will spontaneously self-assemble into like a little bubble. Right?
A little bubble?
A little bubble.
Okay.
Yeah, some sort of like either maybe a tube or maybe like a little ball, maybe like a little sphere or something like that.
Right? Okay.
Some sort of small container. And now, if you've got, like, some C in a solution of A and B, what's going to happen? Well, you're going to end up with a bunch of C, and you're also going to end up with a bunch of these little bubbles. And when that happens, a bunch of these little bubbles are sort of probably going to accidentally end up with some C inside of them.
Yeah.
So you get these tubes or these spheres or whatever, full of C. Whenever one of these like forms and closes off, pretty quickly all the A and B is going to be eaten up.
Yep.
So you're going to end up with a bunch of C in there. And now you're going to get this little bubble that's just sort of floating around with some C's. And every now and then, one of these bubbles is going to get hit by something outside of it. It's going to fall apart for some reason. The C is going to be released. And if it's released into an environment full of A and B, then it's gonna like naturally reproduce, right? You're gonna Yeah, there's
okay.
more of these things.
Right, alright, so bubbles of sea kind of produce more bubbles of sea
if they're in the right environment with
A and B around.
Exactly. So this is one way you could imagine a like proto-life form coming about, is you've got some autocatalytic component C, and you've got a self-assembling component D, and they tend to form these little bubbles kicked around.
And then you're like, if this, is this enough to have natural selection?
Yeah, so at this point, we can imagine if there's maybe a slightly different version of C that just catalyzes A and B a bit faster, or if there's a slightly different version of D that will self-assemble into a slightly different shape that's maybe bigger or smaller or whatever's closer to optimal.
Yeah.
For purposes of the reproduction rate of these things, like that, then there's going to be evolutionary pressure for that. If they could, like, if something else pops, if like there's a version of C that will somehow tend to attract more A and B to it somehow, or like latch onto A and B better, that would be sort of useful. Point is, we have the sort of pieces here of a thing that can, in principle, evolve.
Yeah, although it does depend on the specifics, like, basically specifics of chemistry.
Definitely, yeah.
I don't know chemistry that well. My guess is it's not really the case that there are smooth gradients whereby there's, like, a different kind of C,
mm-hmm.
or a different kind of, like...
Yeah, for, the, like, the smallest versions of these molecules, this would be pretty tough.
Okay.
And I agree that's a...
Okay, but you can have more complicated cyclic cycles.
Could also imagine that once you've got a bunch of these things in a population, you could start to get autocatalytic components showing up that are sort of parasitic in a sense. Like, they're only able to, like, participate in this process because you already have a bunch of bubbles of C and D.
Okay.
So, like, there's some sort of E that comes in here and like self-amplifies from some other components, F and G, yeah. And that would also be able to participate in this evolution, that sort of thing.
Okay.
All right, so that's one possible abiogenesis story. Again, probably wrong, but I'm trying to illustrate the space of possibilities here.
Yeah.
Here's another one that I've heard like third hand came from Nick Land's book on abiogenesis. So the idea is you've got these hot springs deep in the ocean, and they just like naturally have membranes in them. Like, they'll naturally be sort of bubbly. There'll be these, there's like a lot of oils in there, and they'll sort of naturally form little membranes at various places in the hot spring.
Okay.
And they also have a lot of organic molecules of the sort that are precursors to living things. So one thing that could happen is you naturally end up with molecules that are doing the autocatalysis thing.
Yep.
And they're sort of stuck to these membranes, or they're in like particular like containers made of these membranes, right? And they just sort of naturally end up in there. And then you could get them evolving in a similar way to these guys, except they're not producing their own membranes initially. They're just working off of some other pre-existing membrane.
Okay.
And then similar to the sort of way things could evolve over here, you could get these autocatalytic components could sort of gain new complexity in ways that make them better at propagating copies of themselves. Or you could get like parasitic things, quote unquote, coming along that are using these to make copies of themselves, anything along those lines.
Yep. Okay.
So these are like two possible stories of how you'd get the very first sort of proto-life things. Questions about those?
Do the specific stories matter? It seems like you gotta start, yeah, you have some sort of autocatalytic reactions.
Mm-hmm.
There's some, like, crucial thing where you get to a place where it is possible there's any evolvability at all.
Mm-hmm.
There's different variants, and some variants are more fit than others.
Mm-hmm.
And also there's like the possibility for mutation. The thing that seems missing here is that I would expect that there's very limited degrees of freedom in the mutations that are possible. Like, you need a lot of complexity before it's the case that, like, a random copying error. I mean, it doesn't even really make sense. We're not at the point of copying yet.
Correct.
So you can't really get mutations.
Or they don't really make sense to think of as mutations.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But,
right.
Yeah, you can get, like, this molecule randomly folded up in a funny shape.
Mm-hmm.
But...
And causes other molecules like it to be folded up in a similar funny shape.
Well... I imagine that's pretty rare. Like, it's not
mm-hmm.
the...
This is a thing that's been done in the lab, but it is definitely rare.
You can make molecules that replicate their own properties?
The qualitative story I've heard about this, and not personally verified, but, like, qualitative story I've heard is that sometimes you get a molecule that has a certain shape, and other molecules will, like, physically... sort of crash into it and end up with a shape that's sort of complementary to it.
Okay.
Like, if you've got one that has a hole that's shaped sort of like that, then other molecules might crash into it and end up with a sort of bulge that's sort of dual to it.
Naively, I would guess it's like if you had a robotic arm that is making other robotic arms,
mm-hmm.
and it is damaged somehow.
Yep.
It's, like, very unusual if the damage is such that it causes it to damage the robot arms that it's making in the same way.
Yep. So I would say, like, at this point, the, like, place where that metaphor is off is that, like, these early things are necessarily much less complex and more robust things than robot arms.
Yeah. Okay.
They're like doing very simple stuff, like just sort of smashing into stuff and leaving a shape behind, rather than, you know, doing the robot arm thing.
Yeah, okay. All right, so you have some chemical reactions, there's some bubbles.
Yep.
We're, like, not at mitochondria yet.
Mm-hmm.
One
interesting thing to highlight here is membranes... Intuitively, it seems like the membrane is doing something important here. Like, if you don't have the membrane, if you just have, like, a set of autocatalytic reactions, it seems like you're missing a pretty big part of what are going to make these sort of proto-organisms. But it's not necessarily clear what exactly is the key missing piece there.
Well, for one thing, you can't really have competition, or...
Yep. So, you...
It's not literally true. Like, if you're just looking at the level of the molecules, you're like, this reaction produces some sugar molecules, and this
mm-hmm.
reaction produces some other sugar molecules. You can be like, this reaction is more fit in some sense.
Yep.
But in order for there to be the possibility of evolvability, you need to have mutations that you, like, have in a, you need some self other boundary.
Yeah, so here's how I put the thing that I think you're gesturing at here, is by having this, like, physical boundary, this cell can physically keep stuff inside of it. For instance, high energy molecules.
It can
keep high energy molecules inside of it, or other kinds of quote unquote resources. Or potential differences can be kept inside of it, and therefore if there's other copies or near copies of the thing nearby, it can sort of prevent those things from using whatever resources it's, like, physically locked inside of it.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, I guess one thing about these reactions is they have to be like shallow. You can't build a like at a social level, you can't build a complicated machine if people keep coming and stealing your stuff. Like you can't do any complicated process extending over time if where you're like, I'm gonna do step 1, 2, and 3.
Yep.
And only at step 4 does it pay off if you keep leaking the intermediate products.
Right. And in fact, that's true even aside from the competition aspect of it, is like if some crucial intermediates of this reaction are like constantly diffusing away,
right,
then it's going to be...
Okay, yeah. So the claim, or I don't know if this is the claim you're making, I posit that the membrane is necessary because it makes... It allows for complicated multi-step interactions.
Yep, that's like one potential big piece. So that like I don't think I yet understand like what is the main reason that the membrane's sort of playing a central role, but that's definitely one of the top hypotheses.
Do you have others? What's
so another one would be rather than like keeping stuff in is keeping stuff out. It just like prevents random shit from wandering in and messing with stuff.
Yeah.
So for instance, insofar as this model of like protein with a particular shape hits another one and like sort of imprints the shape is what's going on. Insofar as that's what's going on, if there's other proteins wandering around that will just like hit stuff and leave them with some other shape,
yeah,
then once you have this boundary around them, you're going to get a much higher concentration of the proteins that have a particular shape to them. That would be another possibility.
Yeah, all right. You basically need membranes to have controlled anything.
Yep.
Both to keep things in and to keep things out.
Yeah.
Both for heating. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. All right, for our next piece?
Yeah.
So, I want to emphasize here, we don't necessarily know in what order these things are all happening. This is abiogenesis, so like it could be that the next piece actually came before the membranes. But next piece is going to be interchangeable low-level parts. So, with both proteins and RNA, we see they're built out of like particular bases, or in the case of RNA or DNA, or particular amino acids in the case of proteins, and these things are like sequences of these sort of standardized parts, right?
Yep.
So we might expect that was sort of a, how do I put this? We don't necessarily know whether that was a part of like the original earliest forms of reproducing things, or whether that was a thing which evolved pretty quickly. But if it wasn't a part of the original, like something like this, for instance, or something like that, for instance, you can see reasons why it would evolve pretty quickly, right? Like, if you've got one of these sort of systems going on, this C, we end up with this C, maybe it like sticks to a copy of itself, and now you've got like a thing that's made of two C's. Or maybe there's an E that comes along, and then a C and an E get like stuck together, and now they're able to like produce C and D together, and then like that sort of thing starts getting bigger. The cool thing about that is now it gives you what you were talking about, this sort of space where you can make marginal changes, quote unquote. They're still not marginal in the sense of being small, but they're marginal in the sense of like there's at least some reason to expect that the old functionality will largely stick around when you go sticking the things together.
Yeah, okay.
Right, like already, like today in the lab all the time, people will tether two proteins together, and certainly this doesn't always keep around the old functions, but like a lot more often than never, they will like basically each do what they used to do.
Okay.
With some like changes to it.
Yeah.
In some sense, this is maybe more of an evolving for evolvability phenomenon.
Yeah.
Meaning that, like, it's not so much that it's going to directly give the thing a fitness advantage as it's going to, like, make it easier to evolve new things.
Yeah.
It
gives you the degrees of freedom where you're like, well, there's this chemical reaction, and this is what it does, and you're like, well, there are variations of this chemical reaction where you have the same thing, except there's two things stuck together, or two things stuck together, except one of them's backwards.
Yeah.
Or, like, three things in a, you know, semicircle.
Yep.
And then those have different properties such that it becomes, they're doing roughly the same thing, that it becomes meaningful to ask which one of these is most fit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then we get something that starts to look at least a little more like an evolutionary picture. And pretty quickly this, you know, starts extending into a whole bunch of parts. And you get maybe even not an arc, who knows.
And this is RNA, or proto-RNA.
Proto-RNA, yeah, would be the idea. And this is the thing that eventually turns into RNA world, where, like, most of the machinery is being built out of RNA and evolving like that.
Okay. I mean, there's still a step here which we haven't covered, which is that RNA builds proteins.
Yeah, that comes
much.
So, again, this is abiogenesis, so it's hard to know these things with confidence, but definitely the standard wisdom on this is that proteins come along much later, and for a long time we're, like, just building things out of RNA.
Okay. All right, so like, there are some membranes, and inside them are some RNA. Is some RNA.
Yep.
The RNA
is autocatalyzing.
Yeah. And RNA, in that it's just like a chain.
Mm-hmm.
Has structure, and there's degrees of freedom in the available structures.
Yep.
Some of them could. Do the autocatalytic thing better than others.
Yep, and like pretty quickly, once you start getting these structures built out of like reasonably long chains of RNA, like they're not going to be copying very well early on, so you are going to get like a lot of small variations.
Yeah. In fact, I think the main problem is more that they're copying so
poorly.
Yeah.
That it's just amazing that they managed to stick around at all. Yeah.
Yeah.
And
or like you need enough fidelity that your mutations reach fixation.
Yep. Now, that's not... So, a possibility here, and again, we don't know whether this is true, but a possibility here is actually that, like, relatively early on in RNA world, you're actually not getting anything even remotely similar to perfect copying. What you're getting is just, like, a pretty wide distribution of molecules, but where, like, they'll tend to produce something that's within the distribution.
Yeah. Okay. Makes sense.
Yeah.
And then
at least that's a possibility.
It creates a bias for which things show up in the next generation.
Yes. And then one of the things that will be evolutionarily selected for is like changes that make that distribution more focused on themselves.
Yeah. Right. There are a lot of examples where you can make the distribution more focused on something that is not yourself, but those ones go through booms and then peter out.
Yeah.
And then very rarely you have RNA sequences that are particularly good at creating molecules focusing with the particular bias towards that RNA sequence.
Yep.
And then it's still just a mess of just a whole bunch of different molecules,
yep.
But there's a positive feedback loop until that molecule's just there a lot.
Yep. And that actually takes us right to the next bullet point in the notes, which is at some point you get a durable, like, blueprint molecule, right? Today that's DNA. It might have been RNA earlier, not really sure, but at some point there's an actual genome where, like, that particular blueprint is quite well conserved and it's mainly being used as an informational thing. Another place place where we don't know what the ordering of things was, but definitely at some point, the blueprint part, the genome part, started to be treated as mainly an informational thing that was not itself sort of directly involved in the core functions, right?
Because you invented ribosomes somehow?
I mean, ribosomes would have been even later. Definitely
what,
later.
What is the intermediate step whereby you have something that is informational and not directly
mm-hmm.
functional?
So you've got this will definitely at some point have to involve a like two types of molecules, right? You're gonna have like you're this guy, and then this guy is somehow going to cause there to be a different type of dude, like let's say something like this, and then this guy is gonna cause there to be more of that guy, right?
Okay.
Once you've got two of these things floating around, then one of them can start becoming sort of more specialized in being an information carrier.
Huh, okay.
And the reason you might have selection pressure for that is because if one of them is sort of becoming less involved in reactions and just sort of supposed to be durable,
yeah,
it's
yeah.
sort of going to get kicked less, right? It can sort of have a lower mutation rate.
Okay.
And then this one is like doing the work and probably will have a lot more copies of this one.
Okay, if you have a cyclic reaction, there's an incentive. Well, I'm not sure that's even the right word. There's like a fitness incentive to separate out the blueprinting from the replicating.
Yeah.
From the reacting.
Yeah. I mean, even more generally than that, once you have like more than one different type of molecule involved in this autocatalytic system, there's probably going to be evolutionary pressure for them to specialize in things. And
yeah.
Once they start specializing, that's sort of one thing that you would naturally expect to see something specializing in.
Okay.
And that's a thing that would like, you know, focus that distribution more.
Okay. All right, so you end up with some molecules that are mostly informational and have limited reacting to as part of the like whole chemical soup.
Yeah.
Okay. And I guess like in the long run you even end up with DNA which makes RNA, and the RNA
makes proteins,
yeah.
And that whole thing.
Like
yeah.
The DNA is several steps removed from the actual building of
like they've got
stuff.
Their own little compartment.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. Okay.
Yep. Again, at this point, I should emphasize that this is, like, not something that we are at all confident is true. It's, like, a story of how these things could happen that's sort of meant to illustrate
yeah.
the possibilities. All right. Next piece. So now we've got basically all of, like, the most core pieces of a cell, right? We've covered, like, you've got something that's acting like a genome. You've got something that you've got some sort of membrane around it.
Yep.
And you've got, you know, the whole thing is an autocatalytic system, so it can like reproduce and evolve. Now we're gonna start like adding capabilities to our cell.
Okay.
So very basic capability that's not in any of these pictures yet is getting stuff in and out of the membrane. So, like, you want food, quote-unquote, to come in, you want waste to go out. That's a thing that, like, pretty obvious how the selection pressure for that's going to work, right? Like, if it's producing some sort of molecule that can slot into the membrane and let out stuff that it wants out, let in stuff that it wants in, without just like completely dispersing everything, then there's going to be some pretty direct selection pressure for that, right?
Yeah. Although, again, that's a pretty complex innovation.
It's definitely non-trivial. On the other hand, you could...
I guess I'm actually not sure how complex. Like, you have a phospholipid membrane, and then how hard is it to have a chemical reaction that produces basically a door that gets stuck in the phospholipid membrane?
So in the early stages, it might not even be something that complicated. It could be just like a molecule that has a shape where like sometimes it crashes into the wall and makes a little hole there for a moment.
Okay.
Yeah. For instance, or you could imagine some sort of molecule which will tend to bind to waste products, and then this molecule is able to interact with the membrane in a way that makes it more likely to go through. That's a possibility. It could be a molecule that just sort of tends to slot into the membrane and has a hole in it. So, for instance, carbon dioxide can diffuse out.
Just making a hole doesn't selectively remove waste products.
It doesn't matter how big the hole is. If your waste products are much smaller than your food, then making a small hole can do the trick. CO2 being an example here.
Okay.
Like CO2, very small molecule.
Which is true in general. I guess if like you're doing there are a bunch of chemical reactions and then you end up with smaller things than you started with.
Mm-hmm.
Or I guess your waste is likely to be smaller.
Yeah, that
is usually
the case. Like large molecules tend to be molecules that you have to invest energy to produce. You get energy by breaking them down into smaller molecules. So waste products tend to be smaller molecules.
Yeah. Okay.
But again, we have no idea if that's actually how this happened.
Yeah.
The like big thing to emphasize here is that this is functionality, which is sort of clearly going to be evolutionarily beneficial even without having to have that much other machinery in place yet.
Yeah.
All right, so that's transboundary stuff. And then like once you start to get any sort of like transboundary transport, obviously there's going to be selection pressure for it to, you know, handle other kinds of molecules, to be more selective. All that jazz.
Okay.
Okay. Next piece. Internal compartments. So if you've already got stuff producing, you know, membranes, and maybe you've even got some stuff that can transport across those membranes, another natural thing that may happen is you start to produce and use internal membranes.
Yep.
All right. Why? Why are internal membranes useful?
It's the same basic reason why having external membranes are useful.
Mm-hmm.
You can have reactions that have intermediate products that don't interfere with the other reactions that are happening.
Yep. Perfect.
Because either one is delicate.
Yep, there we go, perfect. So an internal compartment allows you to like, for instance, have a different pH in there that would like make some reactions possible that would interfere with stuff going on out here.
Yeah.
You could stick your information carrier in there so that it's sort of sealed off from whatever crap is going on elsewhere. You could just have this guy be a little storage vessel for waste, anything along those lines.
Yep.
You could also just have it as a have the membrane itself be the functional part. It turns out a lot of proteins, just like our membrane proteins, that do something sort of naturally likes being embedded in a membrane.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do you have a guess for what the first internal compartment is?
That's a tough one. A lot of like the smallest cells don't really have internal compartments, so my guess is they came along relatively late in the process.
Yeah.
Nucleus is an obvious guess. Just some sort of inclusion is another natural one, like sort of like mitochondria seem to have come from some sort of bacteria getting captured inside a mammalian cell and then they co-evolve.
Yeah.
Something along those lines would be another sort of natural guess.
Okay.
All right, now for a big one. The thing that I would call the first level of actual agency is you start to take different actions depending on your environment in order to like make outcomes happen more consistently.
Yep.
So in this case, it would be taking different actions as a function of your environment in order to make the cell reproduce more often.
Yeah.
How does that happen? So.
Yeah, I mean, I notice we're talking about actions.
Yep.
Which, there's not obviously this is just chemical reactions.
Yep, that is exactly the right thing to be focusing on here. What does it mean to take an action when we're at the level of, like, these things?
I mean, I guess you have chemicals. Can you have chemical circuits?
Mm-hmm. Sure can.
Can you make an AND gate or a IF out of
Yep, that's basically the right idea. So what we can have at this level is something like so we've got these reactions going on, and you could have a catalyzer here that maybe that catalyzer catalyzes this reaction differently if it's bound to some A. Right? So like maybe if the catalyzer binds to A, this would be a relatively simple case, then it gets into this bound state that doesn't catalyze the reaction. Right? That would be a relatively simple one, happens all the time in the real systems. And now you're effectively taking a different action, i.e. catalyzing or not catalyzing this reaction, in response to what's in the system.
Yeah.
Probably this is not the way you'd want to do it, actually. Probably you'd want to divide to C. Yeah. Producing less when there's more A. I guess you'd go either way here, depending on what you want. But yeah, point is it binds to something that's involved in the reaction.
Yeah.
In order to turn it on or off.
Okay.
So that would be sort of the bare minimum, simplest possible, taking different actions in response to different inputs. But that's still sort of internal to the system, right? It's catalyzing different internal reactions in response to different internal conditions. So then a natural next step would be to combine that with this, right? You've got some transmembrane stuff going on. You've got some internal stuff changing in response to different reactions, and now you get stuff that's like pumping external things to adjust internal concentrations in response to external concentrations. So, for instance, maybe we have like something on the boundary that's pumping in. That's like binding to an A molecule, and then that will have some, that will affect some reaction going on inside the cell, and those can sort of be then wired to other things. if there's a lot of things that depend on A, for instance, in the cell, then what you potentially want is some sort of A detector that will be upstream of a lot of different things, right? So,
okay.
Maybe if we're picturing, you know, we already have this information carrier in there, a thing that might happen on a block of DNA or RNA is you get something that, if it's not bound to A, then it's going to bind to a particular spot on the DNA or RNA and then block a bunch of stuff along that strand from being copied, right? So you end up
not getting very many copies of some things that are going to manipulate A. Did that make sense? That was a long sentence.
No. A is an external molecule.
Yeah, let me spell it a bit more. In fact, I'm going to back up a bit here. Forget the part where it's external. So we've got, this is how we would draw it once we have like DNA involved. So we've got like a bunch of different genes that all catalyze reactions involving A. So this one catalyzes like A plus B becomes C. This one catalyzes A plus E becomes F, and so forth. Now let's say we got some other molecule that's gonna come in and bind right here.
Okay.
And it's going to block these genes from being expressed.
Okay.
Like it's going to, in the case of DNA, it would just like, if there's a dude moving around along here transcribing stuff, it's just gonna physically block that.
Okay.
So these guys are not going to be transcribed, they're not going to be expressed. And then you get this guy being a sort of controller upstream of a bunch of those.
Yep.
Now notice that...
That's pretty complicated.
Yes,
that
was what I was about to say.
transcribing DNA.
Yes.
So we're...
Now you could imagine a simpler version of this happening at like lower level of complexity.
Yeah.
So there's going to be... Not sure what came before transcription and translation, but there's going to be something along those lines once we have the blueprint separate from the functional stuff.
Yep.
Like, there's going to be parts of the blueprint that are producing lots of copies of various functional pieces, and therefore regulators can bind to a part of that blueprint to, like, shut off that part from being copied in whatever way it gets copied. Presumably, the like first way that would happen is something just sort of happens to have some binding affinity to like this spot on the blueprint. It also happens to have some binding affinity to A. Now those two things become correlated. And then there's selection pressure for stuff involving A to be sort of nearby there on the blueprint.
Yeah, okay. And then you end up with regulator processes.
Yeah, exactly. So at this point, you start to get like fairly involved regulators internal to the cell, and now we'll go back to talking about this guy.
Okay.
So now you potentially have a lot of selection pressure to somehow get a signal from outside the cell in, right? Because outside conditions are going to be quite different from inside. That's kind of the point of a membrane.
Yep.
You want to be able to respond to that information better. So there's like, it's a pretty non-trivial multi-step process to get from like something has to be on the membrane to getting a signal all the way down to that guy.
Yep.
But either,
I mean, fewer steps if you're not engaging at the level of transcription, but instead at the level of what, I don't know what you call it, the where you're actually
the like proto blueprint thing, right?
Well, you're like, there's transcription, and then there's also whatever the ribosomes are doing, or the
yep.
actual reactions.
Yep.
Like, there's a different version where you are interfering with the instead of the informational component, you're interfering with the manufacturing component.
Yes.
Which is fewer steps, one fewer step.
Yes and no. the reason you might expect this to, like, happen more easily without directly interfering with the like functional parts is because once you've got this guy here sort of acting as a regulator, there's also going to be sort of lots, it's going to evolve to have multiple things upstream of it.
Okay.
Right, so like insofar as there's lots of stuff that's using A, this guy initially is just like a thing that binds to A and also binds to this spot on the blueprint. Now, there's also going to be evolutionary pressure for other signals that are correlated with A to start binding with that guy. And, like,
pass that information
okay.
To like manipulate this whole cluster of things. And that means
right. Okay. So
be...
so the information, the blueprint part of your cell is a bottleneck.
Yep.
Where and such that if you, it's can it's there's a lot more leverage to regulate the chemical reactions that are happening in the cell at the blueprint stage.
Exactly.
Because that you can cause it to be the case that small edits make big differences.
Yeah, exactly.
Right, okay.
And this also gives you like a sort of signaling bottleneck around this this regulatory molecule.
Yeah.
You're going to have incentive for multiple different things to be upstream of it, multiple different things to be downstream.
Right. Right, yeah. Now there's mutations where you can... you all the A-related things are downstream of that protein or proto-protein, and there's an incentive for more things to bind to trigger that
yep.
proto-protein.
So let's say... this has been going on for a little while. Now there's like three different molecules, X, Y, and Z, that will all like manipulate this guy.
Yep.
Well now, in order for some sort of transmembrane protein to start regulating this system, it could tie into X, it could tie into Z, or it could tie into Y.
The proto-protein, you mean?
Yeah, so the thing that's, like, on the surface talking to the outside
yeah.
can now say, like, if I see X, I'm going to bring more X into the system. And then that X is going to go bind to this guy that regulates this little system here.
Yeah. I mean, it also doesn't have to, if it encounters X, it doesn't have to literally let in X. It
yeah.
could come up with its own signaling.
Yeah, so better yet... it could selectively let in X. It could have like two different things going on here, one of which is like maybe it binds to A in the environment, and if it finds a bunch of A in the environment, then it's like, okay, I'm gonna let in some more X now.
Yeah.
And then that X will regulate these A circuits downstream.
Yeah. Okay.
That's the sort of thing that you can see evolving more marginally.
Yeah. Okay, yeah, so now we have responsive behavior.
Yep. Actually, a piece of that I didn't actually say, probably what would actually happen is you have a thing that's letting in X separately from this function, like that evolved for some other reason.
Yep.
And then it gains a more informational role when it starts like interacting with A this way. That's how it would evolve more in a like more marginal way.
Right. Okay.
Okay. All right. So first we had the cell is like taking actions in response to observations, quote unquote, just by having catalysts, which will catalyze things differently depending on conditions. Then we go to, that gets tied into external signals. What's next? Yeah. Now, we've already now started drawing like more complex circuit diagrams, right? And that's sort of a natural thing that you'd expect to follow on to this, is you get these sort of more complex circuits for similar reasons to this guy. It's like upstream of multiple things involving A. It's going to be downstream of multiple things that are correlated with A.
Yep.
Once you start to get these sort of central informational nodes, they'll sort of naturally act as these centralized information carriers because like all these things are information about the same thing. So interesting thing to note here, this is the earliest point at which we're seeing something that conceptually it represents a thing. So in this case,
yeah.
we have this like molecule's state and its binding conceptually is a representation, like the cell's internal representation of how readily available A is. And it's like under select. selection pressure to represent that. It's sort of convergently representing that by like integrating information from a bunch of different things.
Yep.
So it's, yeah, it's that.
Yeah, and that has to happen before it's the case that there is a code of the sort. When there's A in the environment, the membrane protein lets in more X.
Mm-hmm.
Because the X, like, that doesn't help until you have a...
So you have something to interpret that X.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, yeah. So there's something model-like.
Something model-like starting to happen here. Still, like, pretty primitive model, quote-unquote, but starting to happen.
Yeah.
Another interesting thing that can start to happen around this point is feedback. So
yep.
We've already got a little bit of feedback going on here, right? This E catalyzes production of C. C then binds to E, deactivating it. So you'll tend to end up with a nice equilibrium level of C. It's not just going to keep producing lots of C forever.
Yep.
So you've got some negative feedback there. You can also have positive feedback. Do the opposite of that. Let me see if I can come up with an example here. So we've got A plus B gets catalyzed by E to C, and then I think E plus A becomes EA. So in this case, if there's lots of A, it binds to E and prevents the reaction, so there will continue to be lots of A. If there is not very much A, then most of the E is unbound. Most of the A will be turned into C. So like when A levels are low, they tend to get pushed lower. When they're high, they tend to get pushed higher, or stay high. So in this case, we have a positive feedback loop. It'll tend to like, you know, sort of discretize into two different states.
Yep.
Major reason, a couple major reasons that's interesting. One major reason that's interesting is you can use it as a bit of memory.
Okay.
So once you have something...
Like a flip-flop.
Exactly. Once you have these two discrete states, they'll tend to stay in those states over time unless some strong external signal hits them. So you could imagine any sort of selection pressure to like keep information around over time could leverage anything inside the cell that's acting like a bistable system, right?
Yeah.
Through like similar stories. This guy then, stuff, you know, would potentially hook up to that and, you know, use it as a bit of memory. Yeah. Let's pause here then. Can you pause?
All right.